Karl Ryberg is a polymath, an educated man, speaks seven languages. He has a library, the most extensive library in the seven languages on anything that's ever been written about light, in his home in Stockholm. It's absolutely wonderful. He is a psychologist. He is an architect. He, and among the things he has architected, is the International Light Association. He's a founding member of that, and he's been fantastic in that. And he's an inventor. He's a dancer too. yes, he's an inventor, and he's got a new invention. I think.
Yes, it's not even in, it's a surprise.
Okay, so he's a surpriser.
There is a surprise. I was supposed to speak about monochromatic light, which I will, but then came a change of plans and there was a surprise. And not even Manisha knows about it. It's about our light work. So my light work started back in the 70s and there was nothing around. Got some light training in India, in the UK. Light therapy was very primitive then. And but light was always what it was. Light hasn't changed and light is eternal. But the approach to it, so modern light therapy, the way I was trained, was I would today consider primitive. And the official gospel was like here that light therapy is fantastic. But talking to the patients between four eyes, they would admit that, I'm not really so sure about that. So I started to think light therapy has been around for hundreds, possibly thousands of years, going back to cathedrals, going back to light rituals, Vedic methods. And if these methods are so fantastic, why haven't they produced excellent results? Because if they were that fantastic, we'd already be enlightened, and we are definitely not. So this planet is stuck with a lot of problems. So working with clients, making experiments, I stumbled upon what we today would call monochromatic light. And it means that looking at the spectrum, this is what we humans can see. I will use this modern device here. See, one end being, can you hear me? See, I'm a bit taller, and then one end, the infrared, goes into dark, and we cannot see that. And the other extreme is the ultraviolet, which goes into darkness. So when we look at it, the client will say, but it went dark. It's full of light, but we cannot see this. So this is a narrow spectrum known as the human window. That is what we can perceive. Then there is an old philosophical question. Newton asked this, how many colors are there in the rainbow? And Newton was a religious man, so he said, I find seven colors because they should match with the archangels and all the musical notes and the days of the week, because he was very much into esoterics, into occult science. So we learned that they were red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, suspect fellow, and then going into violet. He wanted that indigo, but seven was a magic number. But if you look closer and ask yourself, how many are there really? And I would say infinite. It's an infinite gradation, it's a continuum. The human eye will not detect mind. Sorry, there you see. There's a limit we can detect, but in principle it's an infinite continuum. I was played to play one of the skills that was not mentioned here. I've got further skills. I can play the violin. Clumsy playing though, but still reasonably. A violin can do things that a piano cannot. So the piano player will say, I've only got seven, or possibly 12. No, says the violin, I've got many, many, many more. I've got an infinite range of colors. And working with patients was a classical chakra set, seven colors. I was trained in that. There are seven major therapeutic colors. that many clients would say, I'm missing, I want this orange golden, that's my color. Or this turquoise, well, there is no turquoise chakra, first of all. But they would insist, no, this is the one I want. This is the one. And working with a continual range of color, we got stunning results. So they would slide through and boom, that's my color. And it was not a chakric color, definitely not. So I started working on this. Something is wrong here with our theory. Or the models are not complete, if we put it that way. To make things worse, I had a boy, he was paralyzed. He nearly drowned. They got him up after 20 minutes underwater, but he was still alive. But he was a vegetable. He could not, he was in a wheelchair, but even worse than our wheelchair patient here, he couldn't talk. He couldn't move. Well, he's still. Yeah. We need to put you under 20 minutes of water. That'll do the trick. So he could not communicate. His only mode of communication was with the eyes. Up meant yes, down meant no. And we would scan through this spectrum, slowly scanning back and forth. And then he would stop there, blink, looking up, orange. Came back a couple of weeks later with the nurse in the wheelchair, total lot, scanning, saying, there. This repeated itself, some 5, 6, 7 sessions, and looking at the spectrometer, I would see he stopped at 602 nanometers, each time mathematically correct, and the boy was a vegetable. So how on earth would he know that? So, by coincidence, chances, I took a trip to Russia. This was during the Glasnost era, a strange story. So there was a Russian professor, and she has presented at the ILA, Professor Karl in Moscow. She had studied monochromatic light, because I found out experimentally that things happen in this light that are very strange, that don't correspond to chakric theory at all. The Hindus knew nothing of this, but there is a space-age light, so to say. It's beyond our old theories. Read an article that a Russian professor so-and-so has discovered that monochromatic light biologically equals laser light. So I paid a visit to Moscow. This was Glasnost time. Was invited to the lab. Had a hearty go of champagne and made friends with the professor, who is still with us. She found, and here we'll go on, that laser light, this is the first laser ever invented. 1960, a man known as Theodor Mehmann, he passed a couple of years ago. This was a huge invention because laser could make utterly precise light. Einstein had mentioned it, but Einstein dies in 55. So for 10 years, the lasers were the toys of the engineers. They were the Wunderkind, as we would say in German. We've got German guests here. So the magic. Then a Hungarian professor of biology started to ask, what is this special light? Laser light and biology. So Einstein mentions it, that this light can exist. It was invented in 1960. In 67, this professor, who is important, Endre Mestre in Budapest, made experiments with rats and animals. He cut them and he bruised them and he broke their bones and he radiated the wounds with laser light and found they healed up. Quick, miraculous healing. And this is the work by Tina Karu. She made studies in monochromatic light. And she always says this super light not only is technically a marvel because this is a laser, but it's biologically very interesting. It does things to our cells that we wouldn't expect. See, what have I got next? Here comes a cell picture, beautiful, magic works. Standard cell, we've got 200 different cell types, so it's just a prototype of a cell. Humans are highly transparent. See, if I shouldn't run too round, I have promised Manisha, but if you place your light in front of a light source, lights will pass through. Place your hand in front of a light bulb, and you'll see most of the light seeps through. We are very transparent. So So if we talk therapeutic light, you would say that most of the light is lost. It just went straight through you. But obviously something got caught. Where did it get caught? And that was Tina's question. She said, the light gets absorbed in the mitochondria. These ancient protobacteria are the powerhouses of the cell. They feed us energy, they breathe, they need oxygen, which is why we need to breathe. Why we get warm, why we perspire, they feed us with energy. They're old. These are not reliable. These old protobacteria were once free living. They would swim in a prototypical ocean. They would feed on light. So they have photosynthesis. Like many algae, many bacteria, they can feed direct in light and transform that into sugar or fat or protein, known as photosynthesis. They are some 3 billion years old, some of the oldest organism on this planet. 1 billion years ago, they moved into the modern cell. This is known as the eukaryotic cell, the mother cell, and we are eukaryotic beings. So they moved in here. That was very comfortable. But they feed us energy, and that's where the light is absorbed. That is eventually converted into the DNA in the nucleus, but these are the light absorbers. Officially, we learned in school that plants have photosynthesis, but humans don't. So we have to eat light, or eat plants, or eat animals, or depending on our inclination. But we cannot eat light. Now, the interesting thing is that these old protobacteria, the mitochondria, absorb laser light. So they made experiments with laser light, with monochromatic light, and found that they have photosynthesis. And there goes the story. These ancient protobacteria have become so spoiled. They've lived inside a mother cell for 1 billion years, and that's a very long time. During that time, they lost their capacity to eat light, eat raw light, so to say. And we can make the comparison with a spoiled pet. Your cat or your dog will not be capable of chasing rats anymore. But doesn't mean it cannot eat. So if you feed it good tunny fish or something, that is perfectly capable of eating it. But it has to be select, fine food. Same thing with these fellows. If we feed them laser light, they say, yummy, of course I can eat light, no worries. I can't eat raw light, so they cannot eat ordinary sunlight or kitchen light, which is why we don't have photosynthesis. We cannot feed on light. But if we feed them super light, like giving tiny fish to your cat, is perfectly fine. Now this is like the story of Sleeping Beauty. She slept 1 billion years, and we thought she was dead. Then came the Prince of Laser and kissed her. I said, of course I'm capable of photosynthesis. What did you think? And this is the science fiction part of it. Lasers were invented in 1960, remember that? We are the first laser people on this planet. This has never existed before. Because what Professor Mestre found, Professor Karu found, that skin wounds, severe burns, broken nerves, ruptured muscles, they would regenerate. You would create new DNA, new skin. It's used in cosmetology. Perfectly new skin was regenerated. And this is known as photosynthesis. But to do it, you need laser light. Or do we? I'll see that I get this right. So we are the first ones. Did you ever see a movie known as Space Odyssey 2001? So they had to wait. But when eventually they saw that crystal that could transmit light, then they could take their next step in evolution. The lasers have arrived. We can now take the next step in evolution and get out of our limitations and the suffering and the disease. So part of the paradigm that we are working with is not so much disease, but it's the next level of evolution. I'm trained in psychology, And in psychology and medicine, we learned about all the pathologies, all the disease, and all the tumors, and all the madness you could possibly imagine. But we never learned about genius. And I would say the purpose of the brain is genius. It's not disease and madness and stupidity. So there are levels that have never been evolved, but with futuristic light therapy, we can do miraculous things that have never been possible before. We live in a new millennium that is not a repetition of the old. So we'll see what happens here. We've got new toys. The therapeutic effects, you will see them there, that Professor Mester found. Healthy cells will proliferate. Damaged cells can be repaired. And this is important. We start to generate more adenosine triphosphate, that is a power molecule that we use as fuel. And we can repair DNA, because no surgeon can repair DNA. So eventually our DNA replicates and it replicates, but with the mutational errors, and these mutational errors accumulate. And with a sufficient accumulation of mutational errors, we eventually pass. It's like making a Xerox copy, but the 100th copy will be so full of errors, information is lost. So what do you do with damaged mitochondrial DNA? You feed it laser light, and it repairs. Professor Carew made some experiments, and she said, I dare not publish this. I cannot. It's only known as verbal personal communication. She had in a Petri dish human cells. And cells in isolation cannot survive for very long. In a body, they will live and live and live. But if you isolate them in a vial, in a Petri dish, after typically 30 generations, they fall asleep, and they eventually die. You feed them sugar, you feed them oxygen, you feed them nutrients, but they cannot survive if they are not connected to the mother organism, so to say. She had sleeping, dying human cells. She gave them 10 seconds of laser light, and oops, they came alive again. No worries, mate. And they lived for another 30 generations, getting a bit weary in the end, and another shot of laser light. And off they went, and that's known as the fountain of youth. And the experiments have only been made on cell levels, but what therapeutically, and Jeremy knows about this, Lynn knows about it, and St. Harry knows about it most of all, that using laser light, and we see monochromatic light, will extend your lifespan. So using good laser therapy, light therapy, color therapy, quality light, you can radically extend your lifespan. All these discussions about longevity that we see today will be a reality. What have we next? I want to see before I open my mouth what I'm talking about. These are the experimentum crucis of Professor Carew. On the left side, these are human cells irradiated by a red laser, very precise wavelength. And depending on the dose, here we've got the DNA amount. This is the total cellular amount. At typically 100 joule, you have an optimum. And the cells multiply, new cells are being made, new DNA is being created. And what happens if you increase the dosage? It eventually declines. Laser light, coherent light, incoherent light, but with a fairly narrow bandwidth, as we call it. So if I backtrack here, how did you do it, Jeremy? Yes. Imagine I cut a very narrow slice out of the spectrum. Tiny slice of lime green, for example. I make it very narrow, and I get a very precise color, known as a monochromatic color, which is Greek for one color. Monochroma just means one color. If the window becomes too large, I say I make a window from red to turquoise, the cell will say, could you be more specific, please? What do you mean? And if you have a window that is too large, it's like playing piano with your elbows, and that is known as noise. But if you specify it, then bing, that's what I wanted, like a tuning fork. You get that color very precise. And that's what we see in a butterfly, in a scarab, in a soap bubble, in a rainbow, in a prism, a supercolor. And they've been loved for a very long time. They were sacred among the Egyptians. They would have a scarab with the pharaohs because they considered this pure color to be sacred. So, this is monochromatic light, very pure scarab butterfly color, but it is not laser. Human cells in a vial, in a Petri dish. And her result, she says, this is much better than laser light. Don't waste your money on lasers. First of all, the result is a bit higher. The output is a little bit better up top there. That's the first advantage. It's more efficient. Second advantage comes here. Look at that slope and that top. So the laser has a threshold, and then eventually something happens. But in very low doses, nothing happens at all. But with monochromatic light, you get DNA stimulation immediately. And in very high doses, you don't burn the cell. Of course, what happens here, you start to burn the cell, and eventually you go down to zero. So this is cheaper and better and easier. And in a sense, it has been around. It was used in Brazil. Brazilian chiefs would drape themselves in butterfly wings and get monochromatic light therapy. Or the Shah of Iran would sit on the butterfly throne, embolstered in monochromatic light. But in olden cultures, they were rare and difficult to find. Some gemstones are monochromatic, but now in the modern technology, we can manufacture that. It's a beautiful toy. It's standing there in the corner. Those of you who want a good brainwash before you go home can try it. Here. The advantage is this. A laser can burn, but this is much more biologically adapted. You get an infinite number of colors, because usually a laser has one frequency and it's set and it stays there, red or green or orange, but there it stays. So you get this seamless transition between all the gradations where the patient will say, this is my color, this orangey, yellowy, which is not a chakra color at all. And it is much simpler, it's much cheaper. The next step comes here. So this is one of the early projectors, a monochromatic light projector. The light is projected into a sphere. This in German is known as a Ganzfeld, which means a whole field. Because looking at the spherical shape, the outside of an egg is a sphere. So you ask yourself, what does the inside of an egg look like? Nothing at all. If you've ever been to a planetarium, it is empty space. Because the instrument that looks at the world is also a round sphere. And the universe is contained in a sphere this big, and we call that a human eye. So if you enter your own eye, you enter a spherical space, if you've ever been to a planetarium, you see nothing at all, empty space. And in that space, you can have no notion of perspective. All distance is lost. All gradients are lost. And you just float. It's much like a floating experience, a visual floating experience. And you will have only the color. Now that color can change. So it can go through the entire range of the spectrum, shifting in any color. But you will have color without shape. And that's a riddle in art. In philosophy, many artists say you can never separate color from shape. I am green, but it's my shirt's been green, or a painting, or a sculpture, an object. You can never separate shape and color, but you can. Inside a Ganzfeld, you separate color from shape, and you have a look at color itself without any shape connected to it. And when that changes and moves, the effect is very hypnotic. So you get the effect of monochromatic laser light, continuous seamless motion, and the Ganzfeld, and people get very high. Talking about Jeremy's experience, part of my youthful education, hippie generation, included LSD, of course. That was part of our education. But it was illegal. So this is a legal way of accessing inner space. But it does things to our brain. And talking about the software metaphor, we could also, in modern terminology, say that the brain uses light as a software. The brain is the hardware, and the software would be light. So light generates much of our mental structure. So you can have an excellent computer, but a lousy software. You can have a very good brain and stupid thoughts. We often encounter that. And you say, how do I upgrade my silly brain? And I would say, light, of course, monochromatic light. Monochromatic light works like a tuning fork. An instrument is out of sync, out of tune, and it sounds awful, and bing, there is that tuning fork. These are descriptions of what it is. So the projectors, you get the Ganzfeld in a planetarium. What is important is a narrow bandwidth. Professor Karu said, below 12, 15, the cells cannot make a difference between a laser and monochromatic light. So there are certain specifications that must be respected, otherwise we don't get these effects. Here is what it looks like. Patient covers the face with a little dome, and inside that dome there is nothing and everything at the same time. You don't know if your eyes are open or closed. So many patients will say, I'm not sure, did I look or did I not? So this distinction between inside and outside, they get lost. We grow up in a world of perspective, because that's part of our Western eras. We live in square houses and square rooms. And living in square rooms, you get the illusion of perspective. Walking on a parallel street, you get the illusion that the streets get narrow towards the end. And it gets very narrow. And you ask yourself, how on earth do the cars get out? Because it's too narrow down that street. And that is known as perspective. Now, if you live in a round house, you have no perspective at all. And this happens, for example, in Zulu villages. It is known. They made psychological experiments with children in Zulu villages. They have no illusion of perspective. You've seen many of these. Which arrow is the longest? Which ladder leads up or down? And the Zulu children have no problem with this because they don't live in square boxes. But living too long in a square box will ruin your beautiful brain. And there is a short description of it. What the client can do with that light. Certain points, one or two treatments per month. I live in the high north in Scandinavia. People travel like in Canada. People do travel in Australia too. So Freudian psychotherapy would say, I'd like to see you three times a week. And syntonic treatment, Simon knows about, need to be very frequent. And many families say, we can't afford that, because if I need two treatments a day, we need to spend hotel costs traveling. So in countries that are sparsely populated, you say, no, you only need to come once or twice a month, and that is plenty. It's like a vaccine. Just upgrade your system, then it keeps processing it. And I believe it was Simon 2 or Simon 3 who talked about cascading light. You only need one photon to trigger a whole biocascade that goes on and on. So you need minute quantities of precise light to get these effects. And it has long-term effects. So certain cases, many clients will say, no, I didn't feel anything initially. I'll meet patients a year later and say, you know, that actually worked, but it took a year. So depending on our maturity or mental state, just the gradation of our brain system, but the long-term effects are very important. Disadvantage of this system is it's awful to transport it. And my Australian friends, good Australian friends, Simon Force, we actually have four Simons here. These are the fourth Simons, they say, but it's awful to transport it. We need to take planes and they break it. Can't you make something smaller? There is a smaller version. This is known as fiber optics. Monochromatic light is generated, just like a garden hose. And in that mask covering your face, due to the proximity, you lose perspective. And it's a tool we've got there. Same idea, you can feed high quality monochromatic light into your beautiful brain. And there is a short description of it. Xenon light, used in cinemas. And I would say close to sunlight, because sunlight cannot be imitated. So the very best light source we can ever get, and one of the Simons mentioned that, that's the sun. Sunlight is the perfect source, and we cannot imitate it, and probably never will, because the sun is a star, and that is nothing you hang in the ceiling. It's enormous. We cannot imagine what it means. So all artificial light means imitations. And the second best light source is xenon. And xenon is used in cinemas, opera houses. It's close, but it's not perfect. And it is portable. What else do we have here? And that's how to use it. Here is another little light invention. This is light to alleviate dyslexia. Of course, essentially the human eye was never meant to read. Evolution doesn't have letters hanging in the trees, so we were never knew what very recent invention. Alphabets are only some 2,000, 2,500 years old. So our brain is not adapted to reading. And many children never learn it. Most eventually learn to master the art of fighting with the letters and fitting them together to a language, but many don't, known as dyslexics. And we know they're 5 to 10% of the population. And that number is growing, because with displays, being in an airport very quick, a dyslexic will need a lot of time to read. And but by the time he's read it, it's already changed. On a mobile phone or in a cinema, they can't read. They often hide it and pretend to be able to read. Yes, and they look at your lips and they look at your body language, but they cannot read. They cannot get a job. So this tragedy can be alleviated with light. And there is a picture missing here. When we grew up as monkey humans, biologically, and the physical structure grew up, we didn't grow up in homogeneous light. We grew up in a light that was linear, shafts of light, entering shadow, green light, foliage. And this is an imitation of it. So if you see here, you see stripes of light. It is not linear at all. And looking at that, many of these dyslexic children say, I can read it. All of a sudden they can read, because our revolution told us that light should not be homogeneous. It should be like shafts of light entering into a forest. And no little monkey would go out into plain sun, into bright sun. It's very dangerous because it will be eaten immediately. Little monkey goes out into bright sun and the lion finds, breakfast, eats the little monkey. So they're usually afraid of bright light. But what do we teach our children? We give them homogeneous, massive light. You need lots of light to read, child. No, that's exactly what scares the little monkey brain. I don't want that amount of bright light because I will be eaten. Greenish light because we're forest animals. Within a second or two, the child can read. Normally, you need to go see a logopedist, see a psychologist. This is a slow process. And to train the human eye into reading, it's not a natural process, but it can be helped with good light therapy. Pardon?
Is it always green? It's one color?
I only use one color. Okay. But the color is not, it's the lines that are important. So, but being a forest animal, any operation sheet, any billiard table, any old blackboard was actually green, since we come from the forest. I discovered this by accident myself. I never knew about this. I was sitting in the opera, and I was going to see Tosca, reading the program, and then they turned down the lights, and you can't read the program anymore. Everybody's been on in a concert or an opera knows this. Too dark, I can't read the program. But in this opera, I could, because in the Tosca stage design, there was light coming in through Venetian blinds. And these parallel light, I can read the program. Hey, went home with lenses and prisms, used my electrician for a guinea pig since he's dyslexic, and found out that don't use homogeneous light. Silly, strange invention, by chance discover that if you use striated light, your eyes will react differently. Short description, this is important. Simon the Second knows about this. When you read, don't read horizontally. This is how we read. If I have a lecture, this is how I pose it. Modern desks are flat. When I was a boy, they were slanted. 20 degrees make an optimum. Then they say, no, let's be modern, make them flat. And the children can't read anymore. Human throats weren't meant to talk so much either, by the way. There is a picture of a child. And what is important working with children, it must be fun. It must give quick results, because they don't like to sit for hours. They just get so impatient. So this aspect of something funny, something interesting, and an aspect of science fiction and futuristic. This is important. With all the text messages, riding on a freeway, being in an airport, flickers quickly changes, the dyslexic is completely lost. And here is another aspect. It also reduces the need of reading glasses. Modern people using bad illumination, sitting in front of computers, getting too little daylight, we heard about that. Increasingly start using glasses. Even little children today use glasses, and they shouldn't really. So many clients will take off their glasses and say, hey, I can read this. We should have brought it though, but the car was so full, there are many toys that we couldn't bring today. Here's the next toy. These are color filters, known as color gels, used in theaters, movie productions. Decent color quality, not perfect, but quite decent. They come in a little fan, and there are three octaves. There is an octave, red, orange, yellow, lime, green, turquoise, blue, and purple, but in pastels. Next, full color, red, orange, yellow, etc. up to purple, and then dark shades, a deep red, a deep green, a deep blue. You can place them, let's see, I've even got a picture here. Description of them. This is Jeremy's son. He said, so you can use them for color glasses. Which is your favorite color? Simple color therapy. You could also use it if you work, you want to redesign my home. I want a greenish wallpaper. This is the color I would like more. Or, there's another one. There is a use of it, of course. You can wrap them around a lamp. I want some pinkish bed light. Or, this is interesting. This is what you can. Known as solarization, been known for a very long time. So you'd have that in old milk bottles, usually were brown when I was a boy, because brown glass cuts out the ultraviolet radiation, preventing the milk to go rancid. Blue bottles were used for perfumery. Beer was bottled in green glass to prevent the beer from fermenting. And you can choose. See, sorry, that was too quick again. Ah. There it is. You can wrap it around a bottle or glass or water, place it in the sun 10-15 minutes, and then drink it. We know that water is electromagnetic. We know that light is electromagnetic. And the electromagnetic information in the light is now carried over into the water. Many of you may, you even have that, Lynn. There is a little green, the light, solarized, colored water. It will even taste differently. Blue water is sweet. Green water can be bitter, a mineral taste, depending on the color. So it's a way of storing color information, because we are some 80 to 60% water. Our body is mainly made out of water. So when we're newborn, we're almost 100%. And then eventually we die dehydrate, like raisins, and have less and less water content. But when we're young and plump, we have a lot of water. And that is feeding information into this body matrix. You would call it color homeopathy, would be a nice way of putting it. Minute information is carried into the water molecule. So that was the first part, what I was supposed to say. Then comes the unexpected part. This is the spectrum of the sun, or the spectrum of daylight. Varies, is it winter, is it summer, is it autumn, is it... But here in the ultraviolet, 380 was mentioned before, here we start to burn ourselves. So anything below 400 is usually dangerous for humans. But this is the range of normal sunlight. According to altitude, humidity, season, it will vary slightly, but basically it's a straight line. It is like whole grain bread. It contains all the colors. There's blue and green and turquoise and orange and red and eventually infrared and loads of infrared going on and on and on. But it contains all the colors. And that is the light source where we grew up. Our entire biology and the plants that came before us and all the other animals were fed by this light source. Perfect light. Dangerous in large doses, but nothing can replace it. And you will encounter lamps today saying daylight quality, or almost like sunshine, and that's a plain lie. It's like buying Fanta with a taste of orange. It's never seen an orange. And I show you why. Artificial light. Here is a halogen bulb. It's not as straight as the sun. Of course not. We cannot get that temperature. But it is continuous. It's pretty warm, but it's not too high in infrared. So many will ask, of course I can't get a sun in my ceiling. A cinema projector would be too expensive. What can I use for healthy light? And we would say, use halogen light. Reasonably cheap to buy, use up too much electricity, but it's the closest we will ever get. And what is important is, you say, there are no gaps. It is a smooth gradation of all colors. You get too much red, you get too little violet and blue, which means that with an excess amount of red, you'll get tired in the evening. But when do we use electrical light? In the evening, when we want to go to bed. So during daytime, we don't need it. That's a decent light source, and it will not be phased out. The ordinary bulb is now being phased out because it generates too much heat. It contributes to global warming. The next light source that is omnipresent today, it's ubiquitous, the LED. And you look at it, it's not too wild. It doesn't generate too much heat, and that is important. doesn't generate any ultraviolet, it's not dangerous, but there are no white LEDs. So the white LEDs that you buy are blue LEDs and they are doped with yellow phosphorus. So you have a blue LED and there you have the yellow phosphorus. And it looks like a camel's back, because blue and yellow don't make white. And reading in many LEDs, you say it looks like moonlight. It's not a natural light source. And this is what we don't like, this double hump. Because if we backtrack it, here it is at least continuous, and then it slopes off. Whereas the brain says, this is artificial. It's reasonable, but it's not what I want. It could be worse. It could be a lot worse. Here is a very common light source, and that's what we have in the ceiling here, the light tubes, mercury tubes. That's what it looks like. Bon appetit. And that's going to ruin your brain. To make things worse, we cannot detect it. So the naked eye, we say it looks white to me. The eye is a very young organ, very recent, only 500 million years. So it cannot detect this difference. Ears are much better. So no musician would accept, I mix a little bit of this and that. No, that's the wrong chord. But look at it. These spikes confuse our brain, and there's no natural light source that approaches it. Sleeplessness, jet lag, artificial jet lag, hyperactive children, we're seeing more and more of this. John Ott made these studies saying this is lousy lighting. It was largely used during the war because it is cheap. Electrically speaking, the ordinary bulb produces 3% of light, 97% heat. So it's an excellent heat radiator, but it's a lousy light source. A fluorescent tube generates 30% light, and only 70, so the proportion is 10 times better. Introduced during wartime, cheap, efficient, and the idea was, after the war, let's get rid of this, because it's not good for humans, but it stuck. And we still use this substandard lighting because it is cheap. To make things even more interesting, a fluorescent tube contains mercury, mercury vapor. And if it ever breaks, your child will be dead within the afternoon. So this is a reality. What are the light sources? How can we use this? An aspect of light therapy that goes into the office, the factory, the school. How is Granny doing? My children, my friends. And we don't consider that because therapeutic light is the cœur de filet. That's the very best light, but we don't eat that every day. We don't use lasers in our office. So the idea goes, let's make a light diet. Tummy eats food, we know that. We all eat to live, but the brain eats light through the eyes. So what would a decent light diet look like? And this is the idea we came up with. First, historically, sun and moon. They've been around for eternity. And our brain is coded to this bright sunlight, and you're lucky to have that in Australia. But also, and one of the Simons mentioned, moonlight, very important. Sunlight is good for the cones, moonlight is good for the rods. So the nocturnal rods, they like darkness. So like any good muscle to be trained, flex it and relax it. And what happens is we don't get enough sunlight. We spend 90% of our lives indoors in Europe, 90 to 95%. And you see, that doesn't sound like very much, 90%. I say, did you spend 2.5 hours outdoors today? That is what 90% means. And most of us didn't spend 2.5 hours outdoors. So we get underfed with bright light. And we say, I've got electric light. That's quite okay, isn't it? No. Just to get some numbers here. European standard says good office lighting should be 500 lux. In here we probably have 100 lux now. Earlier we had 500 lux. Industrial standard, good, healthy office lighting, 500 lux. walk out on a sunny day here in Australia and you have 200,000 lux. Bing! And brain gets happy. It says, this is what I've been looking for. So this is brain starvation. This is semi-darkness. The other aspect is real darkness we rarely see, because we live in towns. We live in light pollution. Astronomers complain of it, but migrating birds and animals and turtles and etc., they get killed from this. Birds will mistake a skyscraper for a star constellation, and all the dead birds will be lying there in the morning. So we disrupt nature. And rarely do we get really dark, decent. Out in the bush in Australia, you will get it. You're lucky here. So the brain needs this contrast. Bright light, deep darkness. Like breathing and contracting, then you get a healthy brain. Sorry, a healthy brain. That's how we were made. This lasted for millions and millions and millions of years. Then came a new invention, fire. It wasn't invented, but it was domesticated a million years ago. There was lightning around, there were volcanoes. Comets would strike the planets. Occasionally there would be rogue fire just burning, but they couldn't control it. A million years ago, they could control it, they could make it at will, they could domesticate fire. This means artificial light. This is natural light. This is artificial light. But it was a huge invention. After sunset, we've got light, don't worry. So we light up our little bushfire. Bonfire, torch, candles weren't invented. We got light. But that meant more. We could cook. So many tubers and roots are completely unedible unless you cook them. So not only was it light, it meant cooking and it meant safety, because no animal would attack you with that fire. So if you had fire in front of your cave, you were safe. And you would get breakfast instead of becoming breakfast. And that was a huge improvement. So now comes civilization. We become modern. We have artificial light. We can master this. And even there is no moon, no sun, because this is not bound by time. These fellows are bound by cycles and rhythms and body rhythms and chronobiology. They go on and on. This you can light at any time you want. So this freedom of time comes in, timelessness. Lasted for a million years. Then up 1870s, electricity. Edison is credited with this, an Englishman, Swan, but electric lighting came a bit earlier. It came around 1809, I believe, or 1810 in Paris, Place de la Concorde. They had what is known as arc light. Enormous carbon arcs generating tremendous amounts of light, not for home lighting, but in big cities like Paris, London in particular, it was very dark. You would have the occasional oil lamp or gas lamp flickering light, but the lanes were very dark, and you'd be lucky if you came home alive. So we think we live in an age of criminality. It was much worse in the good old days. You'd just be murdered. So the police said, couldn't we get some light? And that is how electricity came about, actually. Then Edison, end of 19th century, the Swan, the bulb, a huge revolution. Very costly, only rich people could afford this. So light was still expensive. A candle cost a fortune. So it was estimated that a candle was worth the weak wage of an ordinary workman. He could afford to buy one candle a week. That was all. And then they would spend the rest of time in darkness. With electricity, everything changes. We can light it day and night. But certain differences, because the old lights, sun, moon, and even the old fire, they were slow. To make a fire, ignite it, get it going, takes a while. If you, even if you're an expert, you won't have it running within 10 or 15 minutes. This fellow you can switch on in half a second, flicker like this, and switch it off and switch it on again. known as a strobic effect, and brain goes crazy and says, I don't recognize this. Flickering light, no, please, I don't want that. And with modern lighting, we can flicker it very quickly. So talking healthy lighting, don't flicker, because brain goes mad. So this is designed like a food pyramid. And then going further into history, the lasers, the very top, modern light, therapeutic-like, medical light. We don't use it in an office. We don't use lasers in the garage or in the bedroom, but they have therapeutic use. So this is devised like a food pyramid, telling people how to eat healthy light. And the idea is that everybody knows about healthy cooking, about organic this and vegan that. That's no mystery at all. Everybody knows that with education. But when it comes to lighting, anything goes. Oh, I thought that was okay. And people mix a bit of mercury, a bit of halogen, a little bit of LED, and a beautiful migraine at supper. Of course, brain goes mad. And nobody told us. What are the recipes for lighting? So much like good home cooking, always get daylight and hopefully some good moonlight. Moonshine is optional here, of course. Especially for those of you who use glasses, because we're nearsighted, that was mentioned, there is this epidemic of myopia. More and more and more, modern life means reading up close, sitting with my mobile, looking at close objects. The farthest object, the most distant object you will ever see is the moon. Stars we cannot see. But training your eyes for distant vision. Clouds are decent, but the moon. And train your eye. Eventually you can see the craters on the moon. And also train your eye. Distant viewing, near viewing. Distant viewing, near viewing. Which means that these muscles, your eye muscles, will be fit and strong and happy. They need to work like any other muscle. So this is designed like a little cookbook, a little recipe book. The basis of your diet, always natural light. Top it up with a bit of firelight. We don't use it very much. We use it for candles, birthdays, bonfires, mostly candles. Especially in Scandinavia, where some of us live here, people abuse and overuse candles. For Christmas, it's very cozy. Go easy on the candles, they are toxic. They consume all the oxygen and they give you carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide and some fatty fumes and soot to soothe in your lungs. A candle now and then for birthday and Christmas, but not for everyday use. It'll just clog up your lungs. It's very sweet and very toxic. Electricity, healthier, and try to get clean light bulbs. And then on top of your diet, occasional visit to the light therapist. Much like eating. Healthy eating, organic eating, but occasionally I may need some super mineral or extra top vitamin to keep it going. But this is like a recipe. Very popular. And this goes on. In the ILA, we have a rotten old textbook that we wrote years ago, intended for training, education. People need to know about light therapy. But it's academic and it's boring and we can't really recommend it. Can we lend it the proofreading? Yeah. So the idea was, let's make a much more popular book so that Mrs. Jones can get her light diet right, because she's completely confused. I said, well, they said that was biological, and this is energy saving, and this is an LED, and she makes a beautiful salad, and her children get wild, and she can't sleep. Popular, easygoing, fun book about light as diet. Feed your brain. So I wrote that book, and this is a surprise, because we say, how can we get this light out in the open? How can we get more participants into our seminars? A friend of mine is a literary agent. She presented the manuscript at the book fair in Frankfurt, and one of the giants bought it. There was a publishing house in the US known as Simon & Schuster. They said, yes, we are going to make this the book of the year. And that means people will say, hey, where can I get light therapy? Can I get some training? Is there anything to read? Who's doing this? They're talking about millions of copies coming out, which means we will not be esoteric anymore. This will explode. This is just a preparation. And that was a surprise. That was the first one. So, thank you.
What's the book called,
Karl? It comes out, sorry, I should talk into this one. It comes out in October in London. It comes out next year in the US. But they said it fits. Should we refit? Title is not decided, but it'll go something like Light for Life or Light for Health and How to Eat Healthy, but we're not sure about the title. But this will be more or less the cover. And it means that it'll go popular. All the things that we've kept our little private family, it'll explode. Millions of people read about this, healthy light. And they said this fits wonderfully with the yoga, the health food paradigm. This is mainstream. So we're not secret anymore. And that'll change everything for our light work. Everything, absolutely. It's beautiful marketing. And so that's it. I mean, are there questions about it? So that was a surprise. And it came as a surprise to me too, because we knew that something was brewing, that if I put it religiously, the light angels had something cooking. Yes. And we didn't know when and how and where, and poops, came this surprise. All of a sudden, very recent. And says, this is exactly what we've been looking for, healthy light. And we've been preaching this for 13 years and nobody really listened. We were this small circle going bankrupt. And now, now everything will change. Everything will change for all of us. And it also means that we will need many approaches. It's not only my recipe book, because millions of people pour in, where can I get training? Who can give me a session? So already now, we've started preparing this in Germany, in France, in England, and Australia, why we wanted this meeting to be here in the capital of Australia, really. Because Australia is a continent on its own. Well, yes, but... but no, I know. But it is that. But for the tourists... well, for the tourists, the icons of Australia is the Opera House, it's the Harbour Bridge, and then Uluru in the background. Now, that is Australia. It is Sydney, and this is where people will come. So, no, well, yes, sorry. Sorry, Adelaide, sorry, Perth. But for strategic reasons, so welcome to the family. Start preparing. Because already now we are building up. I'm working with Alexandra, I'm working with people in London, people who have medical question, technical question. We've got a good lawyer here. So many of us light therapists and educators can already now start preparing it. So that was it really. Thanks a lot. No, get the coffee, get the cookies here.